First, thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizer for this opportunity to speak here. It's my pleasure to speak at this meeting. In my presentation, I will talk about the evaluation of the applicability of existing QSAR models and the read-across strategies for predicting the genotoxicity of pesticides and their metabolites. So, first of all, I will speak a little bit about the general principle how pesticides are regulated in the European Union. The organization responsible for the authorization of pesticides is EFSA, European Food Safety Authority. And here you see a complex project schema of authorization of pesticides, starting from submission of dossier by industry and then preparing by reporter member state draft assessment report DAR, and then this draft assessment reports go to the EFSA, and after some consultation commenting phase and peer review, EFSA prepare a pesticide conclusion on the pesticide active substance, and then the pesticide can be authorized by European Commission. So let's talk about a little bit about the pesticide residues. They are everywhere you see here, because starting from the pesticides application, they go to the livestock and then to the livestock commodities like eggs, meat, milk, and then to the plant commodities and to the processed commodities, to everywhere, and also to the ecosystem. And so it's extremely important to understand which pesticide residues can be of toxicological relevance. Here you see the recent guidelines of EFSA on the establishment of the residue definition for dietary risk assessment. And you see that this stepwise approach, starting from the genotoxicity assessment and then general toxicity and decision on residue definition. And this guidance helps to the assessor to evaluate on the base of all available information, like toxicological data, metabolism data, and not testing methods, applicating weight of evidence to assess which metabolites should be included in the residue definition and for the assess. And here you see the some summary from the regulation 1107, which is a very important regulation in the field of pesticides. And it's non-animal test methods should be promoted in order to produce safety data relevant to human and replace animal study currently in use. And so let's say that submission of supplementary studies, toxicological studies, on the substance other than active substance, so metabolites and degradation products, is not a routine requirement. It's only needed when there is a reason to assume that that a metabolite can have a toxic property. And here I would like to say that metabolites of pesticides, they are very different from normal metabolism that we see, for example, in rodents. It's all humans. They are mostly degradation products, products in environmental areas. So environmental fate of the active substance should be carefully evaluated. And also some degradation product present in ecosystems, in food and livestock commodities. So they are very different. We call them metabolites, but in fact they are more degradation products than classical metabolites. And here you see the flow chart of the genotoxicity assessment published by EFSA. And here, step 5 and 6, QSAR prediction and read across for genotoxicity. So what are the requirements? The guidance says that genotoxic potential of all identified metabolites should be predicted by at least 2 independent QSAR models for gene mutation and chromosome aberration. And all metabolites are subject to read-across analysis. Okay, and then weight of evidence approach should be applied to provide the final conclusion. In case of different results between QSAR prediction and read-across, justification for the decision has to be provided, of course. And these are the general principles, general requirements for the read-across published in EFSA guidance. Well-defined endpoint, of course, well-defined and justified similarity, and the high quality of the data used. This is a very important requirement because data quality is one of the most important principles of the success of in silico models. Then genotoxicity assessment. If it's not possible to exclude a possible genotoxicity on the basis of QSAR read-across, it's possible to proceed with threshold of toxicological concern. In this case, it's necessary to evaluate the exposure of to all metabolites. Just in case, if the cumulative exposure is less than 0.0025 microgram per kilo per body weight, it's possible to exclude a genotoxical concern of the metabolite. Otherwise, experimental data in vitro or in vivo are required, but this is to evaluate case by case. And then if the experimental data are required, the testing battery should include as minimum 2 in vitro tests covering gene mutation, structure, and numerical chromosome aberration. So this is some normative documents, some guidance published by ECHA, EFSA, and the OECD. So let's go to the data requirement. In last years, EFSA did really big effort in terms of data collection and data standardization. As you probably know, but they collected for years, for many years, they collected all the information coming from the member states, from industry, with toxicological information on the pesticides and their metabolites in text files and without not standardized, without standardization of the fields inside the text file. So there are several projects aimed to collect all this information stored in the text file of EFSA and translate all this information to the databases. For example, there is already a chemical hazard database published by EFSA. Our group was involved in the project on the data model covering the pesticides output, and we submitted to EFSA data model covering each field of the EFSA conclusion documents. There are more than 2,000 fields. As to the genotoxicity, there was a project concluded in 2017 on the genotoxicity database. From the information has been extracted from draft assessment reports, and it's important to say that it's not only extracted but standardized, because for example, all identificators for all metabolites with available genotoxicity studies has been collected, so you can find the structure, CAS number, name, chemical SMILES, and everything. And EFSA used some kind of ontology, which is EFSA catalogs. But EFSA catalogs have been developed on the basis of the OECD harmonized templates. That is a very important step toward the interoperability between different standards. So EFSA genotoxicity database includes about 380 active substance, pesticides active substance, and 650 metabolites, with more than 5,000 studies on genotoxicity. So it's an important source to pesticide risk assessors to perform a study read across and QSR. So it's important to say that the most substance in the database, they are negative. So it's a big disbalance, maybe in comparing to other databases, historical databases, because, for example, for in vitro bacterial reverse mutation assay, we see that 92 substance has a negative outcome in genotoxicity. Luckily, because this is the database of already authorized and used active substance and metabolites. So then it was a procurement published by EFSA that we submitted a proposal and we won this this call as a leading partner, Istituto Superiore di Sanità, Rome, Italy. And so the purpose of this project is to evaluate of performance of existing models, QSR models, and read across strategy in prediction of genotoxicity of pesticides. And also there is another objective, the last one is to try to extract some structure moieties different from classical structure alerts that can be responsible for changing of genotoxicity between active substance and metabolites, for example. And the project started in more or less 1 year ago and will be finished in 2019. And so let's talk about the prediction of existing QSR models. The careful preparation of data sets has been done by contractor by us. And here is an analysis of experimental data available because all exercises according to the contract should be done using the EFSA genotoxicity database, no other data available database on genotoxicity. And here we see different genotoxicity tests according to the OECD classification and the number of positive and negative studies present in the EFSA genotoxicity database. Then there is a list of models, a list of software, let's say, that have been evaluated under this project. There are some commercial models, and we would like, we are very grateful to the owners, vendors of the model that they participated to the study on voluntary basis because it was also quite risky for them because to evaluate their models on the pesticides database that is quite probably different from the training sets. So the results were unpredictable. So they allow us to use their software free of charge in order to evaluate the performance of their model on the pesticides data set. And then also some free model, free software has been evaluated as well, Lazar, TOX3, and Vega. And so there is a distribution of different genotoxicity tests and a number of models available. Models are divided in two big categories, statistical and expert basis. Statistical is when the QSR has been developed on the statistical base. And for example, one of the example of expert base system is a structure, for example, decision tree structure alerts for mutagenicity. There are, for example, two profilers available in the OECD QSR toolbox, one of them created by our group. During this project, we also signed an agreement on impartiality because we are not selling, we are donating our models to the public domain, but anyway, EFSA, so that maybe we could have some emotional impartiality in this. So we evaluated the models present in the TOX3 and the OECD QSR toolbox software using the substance code without knowing the experimental, real experimental results. And here is the distribution of the prediction. You see on the right the list, complete list of the models, And here in green, you see the data point in the outcome of the prediction for the models, and in green when percentage of predicted compounds were within applicability domain, in green more than 80% of the substance, and then yellow and red for 60-80% and less than 60 in red. You see that the performance of all models, they're quite good in terms of sensitivity and specificity. But this is the result for the AIMS test, reverse bacterial reverse gene mutation. And not here we see the situation for other genotoxicity tests. And it's very much different. You see that the performance is not so good as for the AIMS test. It's not, let's say, it's not statistically significant at all. And here is analysis of the coverage of the training set of each model, and also the applicability domain, how coverage for each model. And then the complete list of the models divided, as I already told, these two big categories, statistical and expert systems. And what we can say on the base of this analysis, they are for AIMS test prediction, they're statistically significant. And it's also important here, it's not visible, one graph is not visible, but here we compare the results on the prediction of pesticides on the 6,000 chemicals present in the literature. And unfortunately, it's not visible, but the rock graph was almost the same. So even if the two data sets are quite different, pesticides and all chemicals available in the literature with genotoxicity data, anyway, there are very good correlation between two predictions. And also, because our data set is quite specific, because the proportion of negatives, because the most substance are negative. So anyway, this study demonstrated that also for the normal historical genotoxicity database, the results obtained by this model for the AIMS test were almost the same. But for other genotoxicity tests, not AIMS, the situation is different. It's very far from optimality, and no possibility also, we don't have any possibility to compare this evaluation of QSAR for non-AIMS test with previous study in the literature, because they are not available. This is original contribution of the CEFSA project, so it's not possible to compare with any existing data set. So, conclusion for QSAR analysis, what kind of improvement could be performed? For example, applicability domain rules to define better the applicability domain, integration, better use of expert knowledge, detailed study of the training set of the QSAR models, and also it would be interesting, we did a preliminary study on the combination of the models, because it's quite interesting to try to integrate and all the information in the workflow and integrate this strategy as horizontal and vertical combination of predictive tools. It would be interesting to proceed in this direction. And also regulatory key point, how much uncertainty is acceptable? For example, even for experimental AIMS test, the repeatability from laboratory to laboratory is around 80-84%. So it's a big question. Now let's talk about the applicability of evaluation of the read across. We performed 58 read-across case studies. The read-across methodology was quite classical, required by also described also in ECHA and the OECD guidance. But one important point, EFSA asked us to try to performing the read across, not one to many, but one target to one analog, because they are interesting, most interesting in studying of the situation when it's possible to evaluate the genotoxicity of metabolite based on the genotoxicity of the active substance. So it's a little bit different, but it was not always possible, because here you see the distribution of structure similarity between active substance and metabolites in the EFSA genotoxicity datasets. And we see that the substance that have structure similarity more than 90%, there are only 61, and the most substances have the structure similarity less than 50%. In read across strategy one, we try to evaluate each parent compound metabolite by means of a number of chemical structural properties. And so genotoxicity was performed where it's possible, where the structure similarity was more than 80% between active substance and metabolite. We applied the read across analysis one to one using only one analog, which is active substance, because for all active substances, the experimental data or genotoxicity are required and always available. So when it's not possible to do where the structure similarity was too low for one to one read across, we used one to many read across. Using more analogs, not only analog from coming from the active substance. And the strategy generated one incorrect prediction in 14 cases. And here is just the results. You see that here it was possible to proceed with one-to-one read across, and here one-to-many, because the structure similarity was low. Let's say this incorrect case, one case, was not predicted correctly, but here you see the very similar structure, negative analogs, all negative, and this substance that really is positive in the experimental test, but has been predicted as negative, but read across, so it was really difficult case. And also important to say that for the read across, we tried to collect all toxicological information, not only on the genotoxicity, because it's recommended by which framework, and here is a practical example of carbofuran, which is, let's say, quite should be negative from the expert point of view, but then we collected all toxicological information. We saw here that it's really a worst case comparing to the analogs, because it's much more toxic in acute toxicity, short-term, long-term, and maternal toxicity. So in this case, expert judgment is needed. So it's we said no. In this case, it's not possible to proceed for read across, even for the genotoxicity, because it's really worst case from the whole toxicological point of view, respecting to the analog. So the strategy two included the metabolic evaluation of metabolic profiles for the analog search, and also metabolic reactivity. And then the weight of evidence has been applied using the Dempster-Shaeffler theory. This strategy generated two incorrect predictions out of 15 cases. Here you see that chemical group for pesticide mode of action. And we used the publicly available software ToxSpring chemotypes to produce the metabolic reactivity profiles for target A analogs. So, and also the some QSAR information, we integrated QSAR information to be read across in order to fine tune the prediction. And here you see the distribution of weight of evidence and the probabilities to be negative, positive, or equivocal, and in yellow is uncertainty for different experimental data points and for QSAR. for experimental data points, for example, we analyzed each data points in means of a deviation from guidance, for example, positive control during the, so each data point has been evaluated case by case. And also for the in silico data, we used the prediction, positive predictivity of each alert in order to construct this final weight of evidence uncertainty diagram. Here, the substance is predicted as negative based on this analog with structure similarity. This is active substance with structure similarity more than 80%, and also in silico data are integrated. So we see this. The substance is predicted as negative, but also this diagram based on Dempster-Shafer theory is provided. So then, conclusion one. So why so different predictivity for two endpoints? Because also for the read-across, we found it out that the prediction in case of chromosomal aberration test was very poor. 8 correct prediction out of 13 cases. For strategy 2 and only 4 correct prediction out of 12 cases for strategy number 1. So it's the correlation in this case between QSAR analysis and read across in terms of prediction of chromosome aberration test is emphasized the general difficulties in predicting such endpoints. So could be explained by the much larger historical database of AIMS results for training set of QSAR models. And also recently some protocols for chromosomal aberration test has been changed because there were too many false positives. So also the quality of experimental data used for the read across was less good compared to the AIMS test. And so concluding remarks, for the AIMS test, we obtained good performance of read-across and also QSAR models on pesticide metabolized gene toxicity prediction. But minimization of uncertainty is crucial for both in silico methods. But anyway, it represents an important step forward in defining and promoting the regulatory use and acceptance of in silico prediction. And next step will be the publishing of the final reports of the project in the beginning of 2019, and also the last objective, completion of the last objective of the project, evaluation of the structure moieties that could be responsible during a metabolic degradation process between active substance and metabolites. For example, if we found some metabolites with decreased toxicity respect to the active substance. So we are trying now to make a list of this substance, which is a little bit different from structure alerts, which are responsible for the genotoxicity change during the pesticide active substance degradation metabolism. And here is the project team. We are the leading partners, Instituto Superiore di Sanità, Rome. And then we have Alpha Pretox as the partner number 2, and Soluzione Informatiche, partner 3, and Altamira as a subcontractor. We would like also to thank our coordinators from EFSA and say that it's this presentation represents our opinion, since the final reports is still should be approved by EFSA and published. So it's only opinion of the contractor contained in this presentation. Thank you.